So now I hand over for the Dr. Grobo sir. Sir, please continue, sir.
Good morning to all of you. Thank you for inviting me to present this talk. Okay, let me start using the PPT, that will be better. So actually my work is in the foundations of quantum mechanics, and this is the most crucial thing because it deals with a single quantum object. We'll start. Basically, is it okay? Can you see this?
Yes, sir. Now visible.
This title is phase pole representation, phase tube geometry, and the derivation of the Bohn rule. Actually, all of you know that Bohn rule is actually gives a connection between a theory and experiment. Actually, so deriving the Bohn rule from the formalism of quantum mechanics is not done so far. Actually, it is still an open problem in a sense. So I am giving a derivation here. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir. Visible, sir. Visible.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So this Bohn rule actually is a statistical rule, but if you want to really use quantum communication, like quantum computation like that, they are all operations on a single quantum object, actually. So we should know how the behavior of a single quantum objects. So that's the idea. So we'll see what is the main thing actually is the, I am going to give a kind of physical representation, physical Schrodinger equation. What is its physical reality? What does it mean actually in reality? This physical nature of Schrodinger equation was unknown up to now actually today, until today. I am giving a particular interpretation for the Schrodinger wave function. And the phase, every solution of the Schrodinger equation comes with the overall phase associated with that, and how this phase is related to particular experimental outcome, that is another thing. So another thing is the derivation of Bohn rule as a limiting case of relative frequency of detection. This is the most important thing. So far, it is a kind of algorithm that is given actually as a postulate of the quantum theory. Bohn's rule is like a postulate. It is not derived actually. It's like a pure hack. We don't know why it should be, but still it works beautifully. It gives the actual connection between the theory, I mean the Schrodinger wave equation, and then to experimental observation actually. But what is its true nature, how it is actually can be derived and all, is unclear, but I am presenting a particular derivation here actually. Later I will give a geometrical interpretation to the same. So there are, say recently, foundations of quantum mechanics, in earlier days of quantum mechanics, everybody worried about what actually mean by the quantum mechanics. But after some time, they said, okay, let it be like that, whatever it is, it works, so use it. I mean, shut up and calculate. That kind of attitude has developed. It was really, nobody is bothered about to understand the quantum mechanics as it is actually. But in recent, for past 20, 30 years, the momentum in understanding quantum mechanics means what actually it means in reality, in what is its physical reality. Many people are working actually. There are many interpretations put forward. This mainstream Copenhagen interpretation, this is the textbook interpretation we all know. There are other things like Deep Broglie bohm pilot wave theory, many worlds interpretation, all these things, last cubism, this kind of interpretations. But the main thing is that though these interpretations explains some physical mechanism behind what's actually happening in the quantum world, but none of them derives straightforwardly the Bohn rule. Actually, how we should derive the Bohn rule is the way we see in the experiment. We actually observe relative frequency of detection in any observation. Relative frequency only we calculate, and then its limit actually should lead to the Bohn rule actually. In that way, none of these interpretations view the Bohn rule actually. They just assume the Bohn rule and then try to explain some physical mechanism behind the Bohn rule actually. So my interpretation, actually I'm calling it as a wave particle non-dualistic interpretation. This interpretation, actually we can derive it. The Bohn rule can be derived as it is actually, I mean from the quantum formalism actually. See, there is a kind of this is known as the measurement problem also. See, we have a wave function, but we never observe the wave function as it is in any experiment. When you do the experiment, we always see a particular point particle on the screen, detector screen. But if you collect a large number of this kind of data, repeated measurements you do, all these points are randomly distributed, but the overall pattern is in accordance with the Bohn's rule actually. That's what actually we see. This is known as the measurement problem. How the wave function, it's a wave, suddenly collapses to a point on the detector screen. It is unknown actually. This is known as a measurement problem. To explain this only mainly, the various interpretations are put forward actually. But in the case of a non-duality, there is a connection between the particle and the wave actually. It is not the wave non-duality means it's not two. Wave and particle are not two. We can actually see it both of them together as a single entity. That's the idea of non-duality. It's not two but one actually. So that is the non-dual interpretation which I have put forward. So let us see actually. So there are various aspects of this non-dualistic interpretation. Since in the present talk, I am interested only to show the derivation of the Bohn rule, let us look at this inner product actually. See, this inner product, we can ask three fundamental questions actually. For example, what is the physical nature of this psi? Starting in the state vector, quantum state vector, or its position basis representation known as the Schrodinger wave function. What is its physical meaning? That is one question we can definitely ask. And suppose if you think that psi is physically existing, it's in real, because that itself is debating. People are debating. Psi is not real. Some people say it's called epistemological interpretations. Some people argue that psi is real, ontological, psi ontic interpretations. There are two kinds actually. So some people consider psi only as a knowledge. Some people consider it is really existing in nature actually. Knowledge general, if you are really doing the fundamental science, such a concepts like epistemological concepts cannot be entertained. It should be some sort of quantic quantity. I mean, physically, it should exist. Suppose if psi really exists, then we should ask, psi exists in the physical nature, then where this dual exists in the same nature? So we should answer this thing. And another thing, this inner product, if psi is a multiple of an overall phase factor, this inner product becomes independent of the phase factor actually. So the question is that phase factor has any role to play? For example, in the case of a wave is actually in the experiment observed as a single point particle. Is this phase is doing something? That is the another thing one can actually ask. These are the three questions we can ask in this case of inner product. I mean, this is actually the Bohn rule. When you equate it to one, this is actually a Bohn rule actually. So let us see. So physical nature of the Schrodinger equation, I give a short derivation. To consider a one-dimensional case of a free particle moving in one dimension, it's the classical Hamiltonian is this one and the quantum mechanical Hamiltonian is this one. We know that if you solve the quantum mechanical, classical Hamiltonian equations of motion, we get the equations of motion like this, where x of t is the position of the particle as a function of time, and similarly p of t. So what is the main thing is that, but if you solve the quantum mechanical case, the Heisenberg equations of motion use these things actually. So this is the equations of motion, which are all operator based relation actually. So from here, we can see this kind of commutation relations actually. So look at this commutation relation actually. This one, x of t, p of t, x of 0, p of 0 is a S cross. Using this commutation relation, position based representation, Schrodinger equation can be expressed either using okay, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Okay, because there's a Zoom, some 40-minute limit, they said, that's why I'm asking. They said another 40 minutes, let us see, if I don't know when it will get off. Anyhow, so this is the thing, commutation relation. Using this commutation relation, position-based representation, we can write down the Schrodinger wave function, it's a time-independent Schrodinger wave function. Either as a in the representation of x of t or x of 0. But both are representing the same physical situation of energy eigenvalue E only. Both x of t and x of 0, if you write Schrodinger equation with respect to them, the physical situation is the same actually. So this is the thing. So let us see this one. So in a classical case, the x of zero, the initial position of a particle, is a kind of unique value in the set of real numbers, just one point in the set of real numbers. But the same you cannot say in the quantum mechanical case, because the position operator, this position operator, initial position operator, this one, whereas x of zero, it has the x of zero as the eigenvalue, which is a set of real numbers. Actually, it is not like a classical case, you have only one value, but it is a eigenvalues of the position operator at zero time. It's a set of all eigenvalues, it spans the entire real line actually. Okay, so what actually it means that, so in the quantum mechanical case, the wave function exists on the entire R. For example, you look at the situation, suppose a particle is emitted from a source. When it is emitted from a source, the wave function appears instantaneously on the entire space, one-dimensional space actually. Particle will be at some position eigenvalue, but the wave function appears on the entire thing, that's the entire space. That's what actually meaning of the operator relations actually. So the reverse is also true, because the moment particle, since the particle appears, the wave function appears on the entire space. The moment particle disappears, the entire wave function also disappears. This is analogous to wave function collapse advocated in the Copenhagen interpretation actually. That's what Copenhagen interpretation says, that upon observation, the wave function collapses to a point. But actually, they did not look what actually, when they are observing, they said this. But when a particle is emitted, what is that? That they did not consider. This is it. Once you consider this one, it is a symmetrical situation. So when a particle appears, the wave function appears on the entire space. So when detection is taking place, particle collapses at a particular point and the entire wave function disappears. This is analogous to Copenhagen interpretation actually. So this is the idea. So now let us move on to the... So the main point is that when a particle appears, its wave function, associated wave function appears on the entire space. When particle disappears, the same wave function disappears also actually. So that's the basic, this is the kind of resonance process. And the wave function appears instantaneously everywhere. So we call this an instantaneous resonant. A spatial mode, where you say is that once this wave function exists everywhere, the particle will necessarily move in the wave function actually, inside the wave function. It is like a test particle moving in the Coward space-time of the general theory of relativity. So now this is the same above argument, but in the complex vector space, I have derived it using set theoretic notation, but I'll skip this because it may not be necessary. But so this one main thing is that psi is like a spatial mode. You forget about the position Euclidean one-dimensional, psi itself, you look at it. It is like a spatial mode in which particle is moving. That is the basic idea. This is exactly identical to test particle moving in the Coward space time of a general theory of relativity. That is the whole thing actually. And this, when particle appears only, this spatial mode wave function appears. Otherwise, it is not there. So that is why you call it as an instantaneous resonant spatial mode actually. So that is the physical interpretation given to the Schrödinger wave function by the wave particle non-duality. Now, the another thing is that in the three questions we posed earlier, there is another thing we have to answer. Where is the inner product happens actually? Since just now we claimed that the Schrödinger wave function is unlike a classical wave, it is not propagating like a wave in the surface of the water. When that picture should not be taken actually. When a particle appears, the wave form appears everywhere instantaneously, and the particle is moving in that wave form actually. So that is the picture of non-duality. So if that is the case, so we cannot claim intensity of the wave as a square of the amplitude, something like that. We have to find something else. But you can, using the quantum formalism, we can show how inner product arises. For example, suppose that a particle ends up on a detector screen. Then what actually happens? So the particle will get scattered into some other state psi prime, and psi particle hits the screen, it is scattered into some other state psi prime. This process, you can, using the quantum formalism, you can describe this using this operator. So if, then this operator, if you, this is associated with the screen. So when this particle, this psi hits the screen, you can see that this particle is scattered into psi prime and this inner product comes actually. Suppose for a moment you forgot this is scattered state and look at the only inner product. What actually tells the particle which is hitting on the screen must be interacted somewhere in this inner product. That is the idea we get actually. So the inner product, how it arises is actually, it's very clear now. Where we asked actually, where is this dual in this nature? The dual state psi is the solution of the Schrodinger wave function, whereas the its dual actually exists in the detector screen. It's like an image in a mirror. And inner product happens on the surface of the detector screen. That is the, this is the inner product. So we have answered those questions, but we have to find out what actually the role of a phase of this wave function. Overall phase is there. What is this? Here it's an interesting statement by Professor Dirac actually. Let us read it once. What he said in the context of polarization of photons. For example, questions about what decides whether the photon is to go through or not and how it changes its direction of polarization when it does go through cannot be investigated by experiment and should be regarded as outside the domain of the science. But what actually here he says is that suppose you have polarizing filter which filters the polarization in a particular direction. If some arbitrary polarized photon hits on this, what actually happens is the entire photon either passes through the filter or it will be absorbed. It is not that unlike a wave. A wave means certain components will be passed and some remaining component will be absorbed. But that is not what actually happens in the particle nature, the quantum case. Particle either is passed or it is absorbed. But the probability of passing actually conforms to the Bohn rule actually. So here what Professor Dirac said is that this cannot be decided by experiment. That's what he said. That is true, but it should be regarded as outside the domain of science. That's what he says, but that's the questionable thing. Why it should be considered outside? This answering this one, this content is the heart of origin of probabilities, Bohn probabilities in quantum mechanics. So to do this, let us consider a coin toss in three-dimensional Euclidean space. The same coin toss in three-dimensional Euclidean space, later we consider in the classical complex vector space. And then with that coin toss in a complex vector space, we map it to spin-off particle in the Stern-Gerlach experiment. Let us see actually how the phase plays a crucial role actually, which was neglected so far in the quantum mechanics section, quantum mechanics community. So this is the diagram I am having. Suppose if you have a classical coin, for the moment you forget about all these vectors attached to this coin, except this red one, this n. This n is the normal vector to the head. The upper, this one is the head and this below is the tail. So this is the normal vector passing through the coin. Suppose if you toss it, before landing, the coin lands on the ground surface, consider its height from center of mass, which is slightly less than the radius of the coin. Now, actually, what happens in this case, if this angle is less than minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, then the coin will show head. Otherwise, it shows the tail, actually. If the alpha is between pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, then coin will be showing a tail, and the tail will be the outcome, actually. But the same coin toss, if you look in the complex vector space, then we have extra facilities, like we can attach state vectors, ket h and ket t, whereas the head, this state vectors, actually now you can, the same normal vector, so these are the angles. So now if you look at the same thing, because this below the coin we cannot observe, so we can consider this space above the ground as a direct sum of head and tail vector spaces actually. So the coin toss will look like this. So when this is the situation actually, when for a particular alpha, the beta is like this. And if alpha, which is the minimum? That is a question. Whether alpha makes minimum with h or beta makes minimum with t. That will be the outcome. So this is the situation in a complex vector space. Moreover, important thing is the once since you have replaced this with state vectors, the geometrical shape of the coin is immaterial. It doesn't matter anymore. But in 3D Euclidean space, it is important. That geometry of the coin only deciding how much probability for head and how much probability for tail. But in this complex vector space, the geometrical shape will become immaterial. That is very important requirement for quantum mechanics, because all the particles can be treated as a point particles actually. So now this one, keeping in mind, this alpha and beta should have has to obey. This alpha and beta obeys this constraint actually, because alpha plus beta is actually pi, but it doesn't matter whether it's alpha is this side also. So that's why mod alpha plus mod beta comes. And we know that this T and H are zero because they are mutually exclusive. If you observe T, you cannot observe H. So that gives this condition. So let us move on now. So in any complex vector space of any dimensionality, we can always write the inner product between two vectors like this, where this one is the modulus of A, B vector. This is the absolute value of the complex number. And e power I theta is the phase associated with this complex number. So using this idea, you can write down the N vector and this space. In this space, you can write down N vector. How to write up? So H with N is like this, where alpha is the actual phase between H and N, phase angle. So T and N inner product, this is the phase angle, and this is the usual rule. So you can observe the coin. So let us define an observable of the coin. This is like this. This is I'm defining because I want to map this system to spin-off system. It is analogously I'm defining. So here eigenvalues for head is half, eigenvalue for tail is minus half. I have chosen this actually because you don't have to choose half and minus half. You can choose any two different numbers. It doesn't matter actually. Why I'm choosing these numbers is to map this system to spin-off particles in a Sternberg experiment. So in this vector space, the unit operator is this one. And using this unit operator, you can express N like this. So from here, you can see that when alpha is less than, mod alpha is less than beta, then this will be the outcome, head will be the outcome. If beta is minimum, then this will be the outcome. So now actually, upon observation, actually, we have shown the inner product last time, this inner product, this one. So you will get only this as the outcome because coin does not exist in this state because alpha is less than beta. This solves the measurement problem actually. This is the whole thing. This is the whole key to solve the measurement problem. So now consider another toss coin, for example, which is from the previous coin, it has a phase relation only. Then actually you write down this entry day like using the same thing. Now the question is, so only phases are different. If you compare this N state and entry day state, phases are different and we have to see which phase is less and which phase is more. You cannot assume that just because I'm adding some phi, this will be always greater because they are all angular variables. Sometimes this can become bigger and this can be smaller, or this can become bigger and this can also become smaller actually. So that is the whole thing. And I think these things are okay. So now let us map this system to spin-off state in Sternberg experiment. Those earlier, what is the head and this and so we have the Sternberg experiment with magnetic field along Z axis. So the head state is mapped to spin up state and then spin down, T is spin down state. This actually, the coin observable is actually the spin observable for the electron or spin up particle. The Z component of the vector space is up and down. There are two eigenstates for the SZ operator. They form the vector space of themselves, two-dimensional vector space, and the unit vector in that vector space is this one. And now you consider the initial some state prepared in SY up. This is analogous to your N vector. So this now this one can be written in this form. The standard everything goes ditto as the coin in the complex vector space actually. So now this one SY is like this. Now let us look at the diagram. That will be more easy to understand. So this is the SY, which is the filter. Filter means basically another Sternberg experiment which allows only electrons with a spin up in y direction. They are the one which are allowed. This is the Sternberg experiment with magnetic field along z axis. and it has the vector, it's a state space, means spin up and spin down states. When this electron encounters this SY, it can be written using this earlier thing, this one. This is the formula. So now this one, actually this SY, now this becomes in terms of SY, SZ up and SZ down, this is the superposition, this plus this. These are the two states. And the particle, for the case when alpha is less than beta, the particle will be present in this up state and no particle will be present in the down state. It does not mean this state doesn't exist. This ontological state, it exists. The both are, it's a vector space. You cannot simply chop out one component. Both component exist, but particle exists only in this component. So when this vector hits the screen, a dual state is excited in the screen. So that has inner product. This is the earlier I was telling the questions. The inner product actually happens here on the screen. And the dual state is excited in the screen. It's like an image in the mirror. And this is the actual state, Schrodinger state. So you can see that this particle will be hitting somewhere here. Nothing will appear here because there is no particle to contribute here. So this automatically solves the measurement problem. There is no measurement. There is a whole thing which is hitting and naturally particle appears at particular state. Okay, this is the whole idea about how wave particle non-duality explains, solves the measurement problem. So now let us move on to this one. This is the same thing what is there in the diagram. So the SY, if you take the inner product, that is what is happening here on the surface. In this inner product, you have both, but this only has the particle, so only this contributes. So the particle gives a point, contributes a point to this, and we observe eigenvalue half. That's all the thing. Okay. Suppose if you have another spin state, which is has the phase difference with the previous spin state by I5, then this one can be written using the same unit vector. So it's like this. It's exactly like the case what I explained in the case of coin. So only phases you have to look which phase is minimum. If this is minimum, then the particle will be in SZ state. If beta plus phi is minimum, then particle will be found in SZ down state actually. So that is the thing. So now I will represent this thing, geometrical representation. Why I am calling phase, whole phase, cube and all will be very clear. So I will be, I think 5 minutes, I will finish this. So various spin states filtered through FY, you can write down this way. This is what we have, we can write down. Actually earlier I have written down the same thing, but here I did not put alpha as a function of alpha. Now I am putting it. Why I am putting it? Because the states are dependent upon the phases. So actually you can see one thing, for different particles, what is actually difference is the phases are different actually. Different particles will come with different phases. So you don't have to write every time like this. These phases, alpha and beta, you regard them as different for a different particle. That's enough. So if you see that this alpha and beta will be different for a different particles, so, but they are related by a constant. Mod alpha plus mod beta is pi, equal to pi. So they are not independent. So any one you can take as a variable. So I take is alpha. So here I take state itself is dependent upon alpha. So this alpha is a random actually. It is not, alpha will not occur. It's not a smooth variable. For every particle will come with a different alphas. Okay. So what you do is that you collect all these states as in a set. Collect all these states. Obviously the phi will go from 0 to 2 pi. So when for all, but this phi will occur between 0 to 2 pi randomly, not continuously from 0 to 2 pi. Somewhere, some value here, some value here. But when they put them all of them together, it will span entire 0 to 2 pi range actually. So collect all such vectors and then plot them on a complex vector plane. This set you plot on a complex vector plane, then you will see this something like this. So the tip of all those vectors, will form a circle of a conference. It's a unit circle because the coefficient is normalized to one. This SY is normalized to one. So it's a unit circle, circle of unit radius. That's what actually happens. So when the particle is moving, this circle is moving. So it actually sweeps a tube. But if you look at this one, this test, since SY can be written like this one circle, when it moves, it forms a tube. Anything, for example, you look at it. This is a kind of a circle. So why not? You can also say this is also forms a circle. This is also forms a circle. So you draw the circles like that, and then connect them. It will form a kind of a tube. The interpretation is that when a particle moves, so the phase hole moves, and it branches into two tubes. Let me tell why I am calling this a phase hole. Is reason is this: any vector, so the filter FI filter has a single direction actually. But that is in our perspective, the filter FI filter has a single direction. It filters the particles in up along y direction. But from quantum particle perspective, it won't see the single direction. It will see a hole actually, because for any alpha, it will pass through this hole. If this will come, it will pass through. If this will come, it will pass through. So it is like a hole actually. Single direction from our perspective is like a hole in the perspective of a quantum particle actually. So this is a hole, and this is a hole, and this is a hole. And if you connect a join all of them, it forms a tube like this. So particles entering here will come out at here and here actually. So let us, for example, this is drawn for equal amplitude case and unequal amplitude case. Let us look at the derivation. So same thing. Let's look at this one. So what actually I'm this? Let me namings. You should remember actually the phase tube. This everything is phase tube. This is upper tube. Phase lower tube. I call it phase upper tube and phase lower tube. So you can see that phase upper hole, upper tube, any vector from here and any vector from here are orthogonal because they are opposite spins, spin states. So their intersection will be always a null set. So what actually, so when a particle moves, this PH, the hole sweeps a tube, this is not PT, which branches into PUT, upper tube and lower tube, because it's a superposition of two eigenstates. So PUT and PDT are phase tube generated by this two phase holes. So now let us look at the case actually. Remember the diagram in mind. When a huge number of particles are entering, say n of them, some of them will pass through the upper tube and some of them will pass through the lower tube. Say nu is the number of particles passing through the upper tube and the nd is the number of particles passing through the down tube actually. Obviously, the total number of particles are conserved. So n equal to nu plus nd. Also from the geometrical factor, you can write down nu equal to au by a, n and nd is this one. Here a, au, ad are the cross sections, area of cross sections of phase tubes, pu, upper tube and lower tube section. So from this relation, you can write down this simple relation. So nu by n plus n, this one, area by area, this one. This is actually, I call this ru and rd, where ri is ni by ni, ai by ai. This is actually the relative frequency of detection. That's what we see by experiment. This is actually the probability, because area by area, it is not numbers. It does not have to converge like numbers. Histogram, for example, histogram for this numbers, it will slowly, as n goes to infinity, it will actually converge just to this number actually. So this is the bone probability and this is the relative frequency of detection. When n goes to infinity, both are same actually. This is the derivation for bone rule. Okay, which non-dualistic interpretation gives. So now we have to know how many particles moves in the upper tube and lower tube. Write down the area relation. Yeah, from the same relation, you can write down A equal to AU plus AD. And just to compute the area, it's a unit circle, unit radius, so pi. This and all having the radius 1 by square root of 2. So these are the areas. This equation tells us that the interval 0 to pi actually splits like 0 to pi by 2 and 0 pi by 2 to pi. That is the splitting of the area. But the physical phenomenon pi to 2 pi is actually same as 0 to pi. That I have already shown. Alpha and minus alpha, both are same. So that's why modulus has come. So therefore, depending upon alpha belongs to this range, it goes to upper tube. When alpha belongs to this range, it goes to lower tube actually. So there is no confusion. So which particle goes where also, this non-dualistic interpretation explains. Suppose if you have a superposition of eigenstates with unequal amplitudes, this is a mistake. I mean, any interpretation has a problem in explaining this unequal amplitude superposition actually. The reason is this actually. They are not like coins in a three-dimensional Euclidean space. They all behave like a point particle. For example, in Young's double slit experiment, many experiments were done using macromolecules, large molecules. but only center of mass motion is important actually. Its structure of the molecule doesn't matter. It doesn't play any role like a shape of the coil in a Euclidean space. So if that is the case, and moreover, all the particles are independent. You can fire them one at a time actually. If that is the case, how each particle knows 1/4 of them should enter the upper tube and 3/4 of them enter the lower tube? How can they decide actually? There is no way actually. But this phase two structure is automatically tells you that this is the way it has to go. For example, if an incompressible fluid is flowing through this phase tube, naturally, depending on the area, the fluid will split and go. That is the thing. Okay. So now you can all the phase tube details for this state is exactly identical to equal amplitude case actually, the earlier case one. But only thing we have to compute is how the area splits. Cross-sectional area. So you can compute this is in the area relation. This pi now compute for AU, this is this much, AD, it is this one. This relation is telling us that splitting of this interval as 0 to pi by 4 and pi by 4 to pi. So if alpha belongs to this 0 to pi by 4, it is going to enter into the upper tube. If alpha belongs to this one, it enters into this. This is a single particle. It is that it has a structure. Point structure is does not have is a point particle, single particle, independent particle. But alpha, the phase is deciding whether it is found in the upstate or a downstate. That is the whole idea. So the same thing I have generalized here for the general case. I think this is a straightforward thing. Right, then general state where this RU is these things and how the interval splits exactly can compute this way. That is the this is the way it splits and now consider for example if you have what is the idea actually how detection happens then dual is excited and inner product happens so that is the this is the dual excited this is the dual excited in the detector screen inner product is happening and if alpha belongs to this range then now only this will contribute this has no particle so this is the outcome but see this consistently from the area conservation also this one also you see this thing area this also gives the same relation like this so whether you put a one particle at a time or all particles at the same time it doesn't matter actually so they split according to their phases and this is the known Bohn rule actually this is the Bohn rule this is exactly identical to this equation modulo pi if you divide this equation by pi then this one and this one is the exactly same So actually, therefore, QM itself is not about probabilities. Actually, everybody is talking probability. No, there is no probabilities in quantum mechanics in a single point case, single particle case, because you can describe the single particle situation in a complex vector space. So this is the important thing. So, if you assume the physical space is a Euclidean space, then you have a problem. If you accept that the space around us is a complex vector space in accordance with quantum mechanics, commutation relation works in the complex vector space only. Then what is the problem to accept the space around us as the complex vector space? Once you accept that, then the quantum mechanics is nothing but a classical mechanics in that complex vector space. Can deterministically describe it. But the only problem is this phase, so you cannot have any information about the phase. It is like a hidden variable because in the inner product, it vanishes. You cannot get it by experiment. So still Dirac is correct. Dirac said it cannot be decided by experiment because this phase information is unavailable. But still you can, you don't have to consider it as outside physics. You can consider inside. You can assume its existence, use it, but then try to explain the single quantum phenomenon. So that is the thing. So finally, my conclusion is that quantum mechanics is a deterministic theory, but not in the Euclidean space, but in a complex vector space. So that is the thing. Because phase is unavailable, experimentally we are forced to observe the probabilities, I mean relative frequency of detection. So this non-dualistic interpretation can explain so many other things like Young's double slit experiment, Wheeler's delayed choice quantum. What is this? All fundamental riddles, Einstein's spooky action at a distance. This it can be explained because wave function has an instantaneous nature that is useful in explaining Einstein's spooky action at a distance, entangled and snapping both in space time. Well-known quantum paradox like Schrodinger, Katwinger's friend, and its relativistic generalization, all those things are all, it can be done actually. It's already done, many of things, everything is available. This is available in my ResearchGate profile. I have a project. In this project, all these papers are available for it. So thank you for your kind attention. Thank